Hey everybody, this is John for Pioneer Nexus MTG coming at you with our next in-depth deck guide. This one is Mono Red Aggro. As a friendly reminder, if you do like these informative-based videos for the Pioneer format, please consider subscribing to the channel, giving us a thumbs up, and leaving a constructive comment down below. So this was not going to be the originally scheduled deck that we were going to be working on. However, Wizards dropped a ban announcement for Expressive Iteration, which means we really can't look at the Izzet decks until, well, they kind of sort out what they're going to be doing. So instead, we're going to be taking a look at Mono Red Aggro, which might now be the premier aggro deck in the format now that Winota is banned. This is a red aggressive deck, very akin to Burn in a format like Modern or Legacy. Although, as we'll see with the different variants, it can vary from more creature-centric to more Burn-centric, as there really aren't a lot of good burn spells in the Pioneer format. First version we're looking at is kind of one of the middle-of-the-road decks. This is very much akin to almost a Prowess deck. You know, you're playing things like Monastery, Swift Spear, and Soulscar Mage, which are your premier one-drops in the deck. Obviously, Swift Spear has haste along with Prowess. Soulscar has the stack text of whenever, if a source of you control would deal non-combat damage to a creature, gets -1/-1 counters instead, making your burn spells a little bit more effective against bigger creatures. You know, especially against the green decks with Cavalier of Thorns or Old Grove Troll, allows you to shrink them down the size and eventually kill them, whereas if you were to play a burn spell, again, in a lot of those situations it wouldn't do enough. This, it reduces their size permanently. And then, one of the newer comers to the deck is Kamano Faces Kakazan, which has various different modes. Obviously, the first one comes down, deals 1 damage to opponent and each planeswalker they control. On the second tick, it turns the next creature spell you cast that turn, gets a +1/+1 counter. And then three, it flips over into a 2/2 haste creature, which has a stack text of, if a creature dealt damage this turn by a source you control would die, exile it instead, which can be relevant against things like Izzet Phoenix or Tenacious Underdog if you happen to playing against someone trying to play Omnixilis in their decks. Beyond that, your other additional creatures that you tend to run in most of these ones are Eidolon of the Great Revel. This is kind of a staple in most red decks in basically every format it's been legal in. It really punishes people for casting cheap spells, which obviously there's a ton of those in the Pioneer format. Then finally, you have 4 copies of Bone Crusher Giant, which is a badly an overcosted stomp on one side, and a 4/3 adventure creature on the other. And obviously this is kind of a form of card advantage if you're able to cast Stomp and then cast Bone Crusher Giant. It kind of rounds out your creature versions in this particular version. Beyond that, you are playing 3 or 4 Chandra Dress to Kill. This is the 3-mana Chandra that pluses for mana and a damage, or pluses to exile the top card of your library. If it's red, you may cast it. Obviously, this works for everything but your lands. And then minus its ultimate is exile the top 5 cards of your library. It casts red spells from among them this turn. Whenever you cast a red spell, its emblem deals X damage to any target creature where X is the amount of mana spent to cast that spell. So, a lot going on with this. While it's not always a game-winning ultimate, obviously it's pretty important. And then, as far as additional burn spells, you have Play with Fire, which deals 2 damage to any target. If a player was dealt damage this way, scry 1, so it's kind of shock with a little bit of upside if it hits a player. Spikefield Hazard plays as both a modal face land, which obviously doesn't play great with a deck that you're trying to curve out with, but if you are a little light on land, you can play this as a land drop, and it can be a 1-mana damage spell, so nice middle thing there. Lightning Strike, kind of the de facto best burn spell in the format. This is kind of the standard for the format. It's not as good as something like Lightning Bolt, obviously in other formats, but Pioneer is generally a little bit lower power format. And then you play 2 of the Spectacle cards, Skewer the Critics, and Light Up the Stage. That is, if you dealt your opponent damage this turn, you can play it for a Spectacle cost. Light Up the Stage lets you look at the top 2 cards until the end of your next turn. And then Skewer basically gets to turn into Chain Lightning. Mana Base, when you're playing a solely red deck, you get to play 4 copy of Down in the Bugbear. This is a man land that's very powerful. You know, for 3 and a red, turns into a 3/2 goblin creature. Whenever it attacks, it also brings a 1/1 red goblin attacking with it as a friend. And then Ramunot Ruins, you can sacrifice a desert to deal 2 damage to each opponent. Obviously, you're just playing the 4 copies of Ramunot Ruins. And then 1 Crucible of Defiance, you can channel this to put 2 1/1 spirit tokens into play with haste. So that's the main deck for this particular version, but as you'll see, you know, there are a lot of variations between the red decks. The sideboard, these are probably going to be in flux, as a lot of the cars in these sideboards are designed to fight something like Winota. You know, running volley might still continuously play because it's good against things like Thing in the Ice in addition to Winota. Red Cat Melee might continue to see play if Red becomes the preeminent aggressive deck. But once again, this has primarily been to hunt Winota and a bunch of the creatures out of that and the mirror match. Roiling Vortex, this card, you know, mainly here to prevent life gain, along with another card we'll talk about in a second. And, you know, obviously this ticks down, dealing one damage to each player during their turn, and then you can keep your opponent from getting life. Lava Coil for killing bigger creatures. This also happens to exile them, which can be relevant. Cinderclasm for smaller creature decks and mana dorks. And then three copies of Rampaging Frostedawn. This punishes both creature decks playing a bunch of creatures and also keeps them from getting life. It's a 3/3 menace creature, so a lot of text on this card. You can see this in the main deck of some of these versions of these decks. The fourth Chandra Dress to Kill for the grindier matchups. And Hazoret, this is one of the various four drops you'll see in some of these lists. It cannot attack or block unless you have one or a few cards in hand, but as a red deck, you're generally trying to empty your hand anyway. And then two in a red, discard a card. Hazoret deals 2 damage to each opponent, and it's a 5/4 with haste if it comes down and it has one card in your hand or less. Second variant of the deck here, a little bit more creature heavy than some of the other ones. You know, we're still seeing a lot of the same one drops that we've seen. Still seeing Eidolon and Lightning Strike. You're still seeing Bone Crusher Giant. This one you're seeing Rampaging Frostedawn in the main deck as opposed to the sideboard. You know, this is obviously very powerful to have a little bit of anti-life gain in your main deck. Four copies of Goblin Chain Whirler here. Very good against anything with X1 toughness or less. Pairs quite nicely with Soul Scar Mage to get everything on your opponent's side of the board. -1/-1 counters. Also helps to ping down problematic planeswalkers and such. And it's a 3/3 first striker, which can hold down the fort quite nicely. And this deck goes a little bit higher up the mana curve, going with Chandra Torture of Defiance, as opposed to the 3-mana Chandra, Chandra Dress to Kill. This is, deals 4 damage to a creature, or exile the top card of your library. You can cast it, if it's, as long as it's not a land. And then, or you can +1 to do get 2 mana, or you can -7 its emblem. Whenever you cast a spell, this emblem deals 5 damage to any target, ends the game quite quickly. This particular version runs 23 lands, none of the modal face lands going on, but still very powerful overall. You're still running a lot of the same lands, down the Bugbear, Ramunap Ruins, and the Crucible of Defiance. As far as things that are a little bit different here, you're seeing a couple copies of the Braid, which is both a removal spell and good against any type of artifacts you might run into, whether they be out of the Karn decks or you might be facing against any of the vehicle decks that, you know, are coming out against the Greasefang decks, etc. You know, so it's kind of nice to have an instant speed answer to that. Scrab Clan Berserker is kind of a pseudo Eidolon of the Great Revel. It's a 2/2 haster for 3. Whenever an opponent casts a non-creature spell, if Scab Clan Berserker is renowned, Scab Clan Berserker deals 2 damage to that player. Basically, if it deals damage, it becomes a 3/3, and your opponent starts taking damage for every non-creature spell they cast. And obviously, Rampaging Frostedawn we've already covered as an anti-life gain measure. This version, very similar to what we've already seen before. You know, the first deck, 20 lands, 2 spike field hazards, a bunch of the same creatures. One of the cards I wanted to point out in the main deck is Kari Zev. Obviously, this is a 1/3 with Menace that whenever attacks gets a 2/1 Ragavan that it's exiled at the end of combat. So this basically is attacking for 3, can be a little bit harder to block. Other than that, the main deck's the same. Still seeing a lot of the same cards out of the sideboard. Other than one card I'd like to mention is Burning Hands. This deals 2 damage to target creature or planeswalker. If that permanent is green, Burning Hands deals 6 damage instead. Very powerful against something like Cavalier of Thorns, which otherwise can be very difficult for this deck to kill, as 5 and 6 toughness is really a key number. Basically anything greater than 3. Lava Coil deals with 4. This one deals up to 6, so it can be very important against this, or against Kiora, which isn't as important against the red deck, but you know, that's something worth pointing out, the different variations of cards that you'll see in some of these lists. Alright, taking a look at this variant, the main difference with this one is you're not playing anything like Eidolon. Instead, this one's going for a Burning Tree Emissary, Earthshaker Kenra. Burning Tree Emissary, basically for green-red hybrid, you get a 2/2 that basically pays for itself with a green and a red mana. You have to be able to take advantage of that, so obviously double red casting costs are a little bit out with this. So instead we're playing Earthshaker Kenra, which is a 2/2 with haste. Whenever it enters the battlefield, target creature with power less than or equal to Earthshaker Kenra's power cannot block this turn. It also has the ability to eternalize in the late game if you happen to flood out. So that's the main difference, and then obviously it gets to play something like Reckless Bushwhacker, which pairs quite nicely with Burning Tree Emissary and a bunch of 1-drops. This deck's a little bit more of a 8-whack-esque strategy, if you're familiar with that from the modern format, while still playing some of the powerful red spells like Light Up the Stage and Skewer the Critics and Bone Crusher Giant, but really tries to leverage Burning Tree Emissary and chaining the free spells. Sideboard, nothing too special here, although we are running more copies of Roiling Vortex in addition to Rampaging Ferocidon. So wanted to point out this version because of the Burning Tree Emissary package being a little bit different than some of the other red base decks that we've seen. The fifth version, no matter how many times I've downloaded that, keeps labeling it as Bant Hogak. Gotta love MTG Goldfish. Anyways, this one, main difference is the top end here. You're running 1 Torbran, which is for red source you control, will deal damage to an opponent or permanent. The opponent controls, deals that much damage plus 2, and then 1 copy of Hazoret in the main deck. This version is only running 22 lands if you include the 2 modal face cards, but, you know, I thought I would point out those. And then the sideboard, another thing, another card to mention is Smash the Smithereens, which is another artifact hate card that you can potentially run over something like a Braid. The upside of Smash the Smithereens is when it destroys the artifact, it deals 3 damage, whereas a Braid just deals 3 damage to a target or deals with a artifact shattering it. So, you know, it's just, do you want your damage attached to your artifact destruction spell, or do you want the more modal abilities of that card? So where does red stand in the format currently? Kind of hard to say, as the format just got shook up with the announcement of the banning of Winota and Expressive Iteration. On one hand, Izzet decks have tended to historically be a good matchup for red-based decks with Eidolon and the Great Revel, because they play a bunch of cheap spells, spinning their tires a lot, taking a lot of damage from things like Eidolon and Scrab Clan Berserker. While those decks do tend to have a lot of answers to creatures, especially small creatures, you know, it isn't very hard to get under them and then burn them out as they deal with your creatures. Historically, they've been a very good matchup for red-based decks. A little bit different in Pioneer, as obviously this red deck doesn't have quite the power of some decks like Modern Burn and such, but still, that is a deck taking a little bit of a hit, which can be a little bit sad for red mages. And Winota's a bit of a mixed bag. If you could answer Winota, I think it's a reasonable matchup, although Winota does have that kind of get you out of nowhere, while also having kind of grindy and big bodies that can be difficult for burn/red deck wins to deal with. So I would say red was a little bit of a dog in that matchup, although it definitely could hang in the fight. So it probably isn't sad to see Winota go, and, you know, a lot of the cards people would bring in, you know, Red Cat Melee, etc., you know, also happen to hit a lot of the creatures out of the red deck. So, you know, you might see, you know, some sideboard cards get shifted around and burn might get a little bit worse. As far as how to approach the deck, obviously you want to keep hands that have aggressive starts. You don't want to keep hands with a bunch of 3 and 4 drops if you can help it, unless it's going to be like a long grinding matchup. You generally want some of your 1 drops, especially since this deck basically plays 12 1 drop creatures with Kamano. You know, you want to be off aggressive, force your opponent to react to what you're doing. You know, this is a deck that doesn't have a lot of card selection or card advantage. You want to get the game over quickly. So, how to beat the deck? If you want to beat any red deck traditionally, life gain, removal, pair that with some way to close out the game before they can burn you out. You know, whether it's a mid-range deck with a little bit of life gain, whether it's a control deck with, you know, incidental things like Absorb and such, or, you know, Leyline of Sanctity. You know, there's a lot of different ways to blunt red's attack. As we've seen throughout these different deck builds, there's a lot of different ways to build the deck. You know, there really is no set way to build the deck, although a lot of the core cards remain the same. You know, you're seeing a lot of the same 1-drops, you're seeing a lot of the same 2-drops. But even within that, you know, some variants obviously have been running the Burning Tree Emissary, Earthshaker Kenra, and the Reckless Bushwhacker, as opposed to the Eidolon package. So, you know, you're still seeing a lot of the same cards, but they can function a lot differently given the draws of the deck. But, you know, things remain the same. Answer their early aggression, stay out of burn range, find some way to close out the game before they can top deck to kill you. This is one of the decks that generally is one of the introductory ways to get into a format. Red decks are generally considered very easy to pick up and play, which as a burn player for Modern I would generally agree with, although mastering the deck does take a little bit. This is a deck that has fared quite well. It's a deck that, if you're worried about bannings, isn't likely to ever see a banning. I don't think there's ever been a red aggressive card other than maybe Wild Nakato in Modern that's ever been banned. And even that was debatable whether it should have ever happened. So if you like a relatively safe deck that generally can perform in any meta, red decks are generally pretty good. Once again, though, Pioneer is a cyclical format. It's not always going to be the best deck in the world. But, you know, if you like a deck that gives you a chance in most matchups and, you know, like your rounds to be over quickly, this is definitely the deck for you. And if you want to beat red, I would suggest, you know, playtesting against it a little bit. May not be the sexiest, most fun deck to play against, but, you know, there's always going to be a red mage in your store. So, and at bigger events, you're definitely going to see people playing red deck variants. So, it's good to get some reps in against whatever your deck of choice happens to be and be capable of what the knowledgeable about what the deck is capable of. Do apologize for the delay on some of these deck guides, as there were some real life stuff that popped up where I did not have access to my personal computer to work on these videos, so unfortunately been a little bit of delay getting these videos out, so we will try to rectify that as quickly as possible. But until the format shakes out, we're going to stick to some of the decks that may not be playing Expressive Iteration or that weren't affected terribly by the presence of Winota one way or the other. So I know I did say that I would get to some of the Izzet control decks and stuff, but obviously those decks are going to kind of have to, you know, shift around how they play. But that said, you know, there are Izzet Phoenix, there is Izzet control, and obviously the Izzet Prowess deck, whether that remains a thing or not with Expressive Iteration getting banned, we shall see. But, you know, Ledger Shredder is a thing. You know, there are a lot of powerful Prowess creatures in the format, so I'm sure that deck will continue to be iterated upon, and we'll see how it fluctuates in the format with one of its best card advantage spells gone. But that said, this is deck guide number 5, Mono Red Aggro for Pioneer. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to the channel.